be here talking to you today about this topic. I want to talk about three things. I have to do it a little bit fast because Sebastian has decided I can only speak for 10 or something, 15. The problem is that if you want to understand the future of the euro, you really have to know something about its past. And you need to know something about how the European project was created and how it has evolved. So I would like to talk a little bit about that, so one third of the time, and then I'm going to tell you exactly what I think the besides what most of us know about the euro, or the European project is this first time experiment that 27 countries in Europe and 19 countries in the euro area have decided to try to integrate their economies. This has never been tried before, and we are not sure whether it's going to work, if, how, and when. So I need to tell you what I think the essence of the euro is, and then discuss a little bit about the future, and that's what I'm going to try to do. So I will be rushing along some of these little parts, and if you have questions, then make sure that you can ask me, and I can go back and answer them in a little bit more detail. Okay, so basically the first question I'm going to ask you is it talks about Club Europe and what is Club Europe? Well, so imagine that you could join for a fee of about $300 a year a club that offers this list of things: no war, ensure human rights, the possibility to live and work in every country of the club, a single currency, no border controls, economic prosperity. Now I'm getting excited. Okay, this is about this thing. Who's Greece? Who's Greek in this room? Fortunately, there's no Greek. Okay, so I apologize for that because this is not for everybody. Not for everybody. This club does not deliver all the time, all the time to every member. But anyway, that's the aim: economic prosperity, support in troubled times. Okay, would you join? Would you like to join this club? And of course, the no war maybe is enough. Again, we can talk to our Greek friends and ask them: would this be enough? The Greek are not averse to war. Okay, so actually the last war in Europe was organized by these guys. All right, well, not the last. I mean, the last war is one of the latest wars in Europe was organized by these guys. So would that be enough? And of course, the good news is that this club exists. It's called Club Europe, and it doesn't cost 300 euros. It costs about $170. Doesn't matter. $175 to join. So these are going to be my first two questions. Would you join Club Europe for a yearly fee of 175? And this second one, which is particularly dedicated to my M405 students, what is wrong with quoting this price tag for membership at the Eurozone? What's wrong with this? I mean, this number is the number that results from dividing the European budget by the people that are in Europe. Okay, so what is wrong with this type of cost, and how could we? Is this the real cost of being part of the euro? And of course, in this table, there's going to be some specific intelligence about whether this is or not the right thing to do. Okay, so why do Europeans want to do something other than what they've always done, which is be at war with each other? And I guess the answer to that is this absolutely brutal costs of the Second World War, in which the death toll in Europe was about 8.5 million people, and the economic toll was about 263 wasted years. And by the way, I'm not talking here about all the U.S. soldiers that died in some of them died in the European theater, but I'm not. This does not include them. Okay. Every time when I walk back in Veterans Park and I see all those crosses, my heart shrinks, because it's incredibly amazing what the United States has done for Europe, and which Europe has not been grateful enough for. Okay. So how did I compute these 263 years? I just added them. I added. It so happened that in Germany, Germany's GDP in the setback in 1945 took it to 1908, so Germany wasted 37 years. And yes, I've done this really crazy thing of adding Germany's GDP to Finland's GDP, but it doesn't matter. It just gives you a sense of how humongous the economic cost of this was. And by the way, notice that the UK somehow manages to get ahead of everything. And perhaps their GDP was the only GDP that grew during the the Second World War. Of course, some of these guys score, and therefore these guys score a zero. Okay, so in 1950, six countries, the six starting countries of the European Union, which were Germany, Italy, France, and the Benelux countries, Belgium, the Netherlands, and Luxembourg, they decided to start Club Europe, and it got an incredible democratic support. And by 2000, and now there is 28 members. The last country to access was Croatia in 2013. So there are 28 countries. Okay, well, Europe is a strange place. Small, you know, countries are tiny, but they're still countries. Okay. And that's how much support and how much enthusiasm this Club Europe created at the very beginning. Okay, and economic. So there is another deep reason that makes European countries want to get together, which is this idea of the shrinking Europe. There you have the shares of GDP or shares of the major European countries in world GDP, and you see that, you know, they start around 6, 4, 3, and they are really downward sloping. If you put China here, you see what's happening to the global economy. Basically, China is growing, and in 2014 became the largest economy in the planet when we measure it with this statistic. And of course, if you added the GDPs for Europe for the 28 countries that are members of the European Union, it would be the second largest economic area in the planet than the United States. But of course, the second idea behind the European project of Europe is we want to be relevant in this new world, in this changing world in which Asia, the Pacific, and the Indian Oceans are taking over from the Atlantic. Okay, so that's the second reason, and then there's some little technical stuff that I'm going to skip, which is what is it that we did, how did we integrate, and basically, you know, when countries decide to trade with other countries and integrate their economies, you can either stay in WTO, which is what might be the end of the Brexit story, and then you can become a free trade area, and NAFTA, of course, is an example of that. If you decide to have a common tariff for all the countries, a common external tariff, then you become a customs union. And if you remove all non-tariff barriers to trade, then you become a single market. And the next step, which is the hardest one to swallow for the UK, is if you allow for free capital and personal human mobility. So if anybody can live wherever they want in Club Europe, and they can work wherever they want in Club Europe without any restrictions. So that means that if all the Polish people wanted to move to the UK, they could, okay? And the UK could do nothing to prevent this huge migration that, of course, creates distortions in anybody's economy. Okay, so then some guys, of course, this club was not ideal because there were too many currencies, okay? And when you have currencies, you can change the value of these currencies. You can manage the currencies in such a way that you're creating a tariff, okay? Depreciating a currency and putting a tariff in many senses, it's similar. So Europe for a while tried to align their exchange rates and failed miserably. Okay, so our experience in the 1980s says when you have a group of countries trying to do a lot of trade with each other and approximate their economies, if they have exchange rates, it's just not going to work. And it was continuous exchange rate crisis between the Deutschmark and the French franc and maybe the Italian lira and all kinds of speculation. George Soros became a millionaire because of that. That was the only thing. He got incredibly lucky speculating against the British pound. And so it was not working. So some guy said, okay, let's go for it. And let's go for it was create a single currency, which of course is this really hardwired mechanism of fixed exchange rates. Okay, so 11 countries in 1999 and 19 countries in 2017. The last country to access was Lithuania only 2 years ago. Okay? So now there's 19 countries in Europe, and again, there's small places, many of them, but they're still countries, that have decided we're just going to throw away our currency, we're going to throw away our monetary policy, we're going to have a single monetary policy. Essentially, let me tell you what they did. So they went into a monetary union, okay? And this created this Euro 1.0, which is a system of fixed exchange rates that we already that I've already discussed or described, single monetary policy, so you are giving probably the main tool, or according to many, the main tool for short-term management of an economy. Now you're going to have to get one size that is not going to fit all. And who is it going to fit the best? Always the same, Germany. Okay? Why? Because the euro is German's plan. Okay? Germany's plan. So we have to do that. Germany decides that the ECB is going to, you know, which of course is the Bundesbank, except we changed the name. It's still in Frankfurt, so it moved, but it's there, and it shares this obsession with Germany, with inflation, because of the memory from the hyperinflation of the interwar period still lingers in Germany, and for Germans, 2.001 is a hyperinflation. That's just about to happen. Okay, so they said 2, which is a crazy number because it's too close to zero. And 4 would have been much nicer, except Germans say 4 is intolerable inflation. Okay, so it has to be 2. And then there were this 19 supervisor. Can you imagine how you're going to manage this banking system with 19 guys that are doing whatever it is they do? They were only forced to do one thing. They have to say it has to. They change their names. They put Euro system everywhere, but that's the only thing that changed. Okay, and you could do it in different languages. So they all have it. They all have it somewhere in their little logos. So there were 19 of these, and there was something called this Pact of Stability and Growth that was supposed to limit deficits, because of course you're only left with fiscal policy to manage the economy, because monetary policy is gone, exchange rate policy is gone, and you only have fiscal policy. So there's going to be a lot of burden being placed on fiscal authorities to manage the economy, to ensure growth, and to do the any kind of macroeconomic stabilization that might be needed. Okay, and then. Was this thing, which is Article 1, this is for my friends, the lawyers here, Article 104B of the Maastricht Treaty says explicitly excludes solidarity. So it says no country shall be responsible for any other country, and the union shall not be responsible for the decisions of any other country, okay? So that is still part of the treaties, and of course that opens it to fascinating discussions where these guys that wear these funny robes are the magistrates of Germany's Supreme Court that have to decide if what the ECB is doing is legal or not, and they always meet and Europe has to hold its breath, waiting for these guys to make the right decisions. So you know, in a way, the Europe reminds me of this great song. There's no exit, okay? There's no exit. Just like from Hotel California, no? You can check out, but you cannot leave, okay? No matter what you do. So, and now you should be hearing the song, but it's not singing for some reason, okay? So it's very unfortunate, but you all know the song, and it says, Lena, welcome to... Yeah, welcome to the whole of California. You can California. You can check out, but you can never leave. Okay, you can check out anytime you want, but you can never leave. Okay, that's the idea. So Greece can check out anytime it wants, but it can never leave. There it is with us. Okay, all right. So some renowned economists said, this is what they said. They said this euro will not work. Okay, and we said it big and loud. I mean, and we, in situations like this, we said, no, this is impossible. It's a crazy idea. It's not going to work. Okay, and we gave these guys Nobel Prizes. Robert Mundell, in 1999, he said the eurozone is not an optimum currency era, and we gave them L. Okay, which we only have one prize in economics, and it's really, really precious. Like Sebastian might get one, I will not, and we are both pissed off because where is our prize? I mean, I've accepted it. He's still in the run. Okay, so where's our price? We don't know. Mundell got it, just for saying the eurozone is not an optimal currency area. Okay, so what, you know, that means some things. If somebody wants to ask me about it, ask me later. This is a much nicer guy. This guy is Franco Modigliani. He got a Nobel Prize as well a little bit earlier, so let's give him the medal. And this guy was invited to Spain. In Spain, everybody was for the euro like there's no tomorrow. Nobody complained, except for one guy, except for the Communist Trade Union, which was called Comisiones Obreras, and they had some doubts. So they invited this guy, and who was by then a really charming and extremely smart, you know, all gentleman, and he said, this is what he said. He said, the monetary union is like an iron umbrella. That was his metaphor. It protects country from the rain, but to make it work, their peoples must be able to lift this umbrella, which is very heavy. And if you want to lift the umbrella, you have to work out a lot. And now notice, and this was said in 1992, just before the Maastricht Treaty was signed. Okay, so look how prescient this guy was. That's what he said. But if the Greek, the Portuguese, the Spaniards, and the Italian, he nailed them exactly, okay, exactly, have chosen not to work out as much as Germans outside the monetary union, why would they suddenly want to start working out like crazy once they're in to lift the umbrella? And once you are under the umbrella, you have to lift it if you want to breathe, don't you, Nicole? Yes, you do. And you cannot do it because that goes against all everything that you've been used to. Okay? So that's what Franco said in 1992, just before that. And of course this guy again another friend, he was the governor of the Bank of Greece, and he warned the Greek people. He said, hey, wait a minute, because we go in, this is what's gonna happen. And you know, so he said, after the euro entering the euro area, the Bank of Greece will be implementing the single monetary policy decided by the governing council of the European Central Bank. It will certainly be impossible, that's what this guy's saying, to improve the international competitiveness by changing the exchange rate of our new currency, the euro. We are just not going to be able to ever devalue the drachma again, which is what the Greek were doing every other 6 months, okay? Because that was the easy way out, making, nobody complains when you do that, okay? And then he said, look, the objective of higher employment and output growth will have to be pursued through structural reforms. Like, who wants to do a structural reform if you are in the south of Europe? Fiscal measures aimed at enhancing international competitiveness by increasing productivity. That's so incredibly hard to do. You know, like try to do 50% more of anything you do. Like you can do 10 push-ups, try to do 15. See how hard it is, okay? You can do, try to do, it's very, very hard. It's not easy, okay? And improving the quality by securing price stability. Okay, so, where I come from, they allow us one formula in each presentation, in each session. So I always use it, okay? So this is my formula, they're gonna be one. I'm gonna use it twice actually, but this is the same one, okay? So why does this matter? What was this guy saying? This is what he was saying. He was saying, look, now you can no longer devalue. This is the nominal exchange, right? You can no longer devalue because that's fixed. So if you want to become competitive, your inflation has to be less than everybody else's inflation. And the Greeks say, like, yeah, what? Because the average inflation in Greece is 12%, and in Germany it's 2% or 1%. So how are the Greek going to turn that around? Because if they don't do it, for every year that Greece has more inflation than Germany, Greece is becoming less competitive. And by the way, inflation is a tax. That's why the Greeks like it. It's an easy tax. It's the easiest, most unfair, and most obscure of all taxes. If you want to know why, you have to ask me. Okay, later, but not now, because I cannot. All right, so basically, what happened to all the countries in the periphery is that this thing grew. I mean, relative to Germany, this is gonna be your local price level, and they grew, and they became less and less competitive, and less competitive, and less competitive. Okay, that's what happened. All right, but economists were wrong again, and the euro, some got an oil prices, but they were still wrong, okay? That's a general thing. Lasted for 18 years, so we could take it for a drink or two, if we wanted, because it's on age, and it's admitted in bars in Europe, it's 18, okay? So they can take it to bars there. Happy birthday, euro. And economists score minus one, okay? And you know, but what really, really, really happened, and I'm gonna be done with, well, no, I'm gonna be done, because he's getting very upset, and so I understand him. So this is what happened. This is what happened. At the beginning, everything was very nice. Between 1998, when it started, to 2008, there is Ireland growing like there's no tomorrow. By the way, it's still growing like there's no tomorrow. And we're going to celebrate this soon on St. Patrick's Day. And look, Poland, which was not in the euro, but I keep it here for, it was outside the euro. Of course. The question, everybody would love to answer, the million-dollar question here is, how would these countries have done between 1998 and now if they had been outside the euro? I mean, everybody would die to answer that. Well, we cannot know, right? because they were in. And once you're in, you're in a different part of your decision tree. It's, you're in a different part of history. But that's why Poland is there, because Poland was outside the euro during this time. And it seems like a similar economy in, you know, as far as development stage, per capita income and so on, to the peripheral economies in Europe. So anyway, so Greek did pretty well. Spain did pretty well. You know, UK, so far outside, you cannot have another one. Germany and France, they were not doing so well as these guys, but of course they were already rich. Notice that Germany managed to keep the pace of France. And Italy didn't grow much. It grows as little as Japan, but the Italians don't seem to care. I mean, they don't grow, they don't care. So some I don't know what this means, but they keep not growing, and they go to Italy, and they're all happy there. They're going about their own business. You go to the north, these people work hard, they're Germans. You go to the south, these people do nothing, they're Greek. But they're all happy. You know, some I'm kidding. So you should. You know. So they're happy. I mean, they're Greek or Andalusians. Like, we have some Greek in Spain too. So it's not, it's a general thing, all right? Okay. And then what, Javier? What happened next? So let's move that curtain, and then the whole thing, that just this the floor fell. I mean, and the whole thing went through the floor, especially Greece that went from 143 to 108. And now you're saying, look, everybody put 100 here, you go this way, and you just grow 8%. Was it worth it, this Club Europe thing? Because this is what happened. Is this the fault of the Europe, or is it the fault of Greek, or is it the fault of Germany, or whose fault is it? And then we do the fault part of thing, okay? And all the other countries had recessions, and notice that therefore, for the US that was not so looking so good here, now it's looking much better because the US recovered much faster. Okay, fine. And now we do the same thing with interest rates. This is very important for what comes later. But notice that the market here was saying Greece is the same. These were the differences in basic points, which is basis points, which is like 0.01% or one basis point. So 4 points. Ridiculous differences between interest rates in Greece and in Germany, the whole thing. And that meant that the world was taking this seriously. These guys have a single currency. Greek debt is German debt. That's what they thought. But was it? And then we move the curtain and we say, well, not anymore. And this gives us some hint as to how can you still have not really different rate, not really different exchange rates, but there's something fishy if interest rate differentials are this high within countries that share a currency. It's just like if they did not share the currency, okay? All right, so these were the relative price index that I showed you before. Greece leads the pack on appreciation of its real exchange rate by having more inflation than Germany, and Spain is high up there, and so on, and some of the others. Okay, so let me do it again. What happened next was the rescue time came. There goes Greece once, then Ireland followed very shortly, and then it was Portugal's turn, and then it was the first one for Cyprus, and then the second one for Greece, and then Spain, and then the second one for Cyprus, and that's what happened. Okay, so they had to be rescued. So Article 104B did not actually work because they were rescued by a total of $442 billion, which is a fairly sizable amount, about 50% of GDP of Spain. Okay, so finally June 26, and in Europe, before anything happens, the Commission has to write a white paper or some kind of paper. And this one was signed by the four presidents, because in Europe there's always an inflation of top people, and you know, up there. So now we have actually five relevant presidents, and the new one is signed by one guy, which is the president of the European Parliament. Anyway, so these guys basically said, look, this is not working. We're gonna do something else. Okay? And you know, and this is all legalese, but basically it means that's the end of Euro 1.0. And this happened in 2012. And now we're going to do something else. It's going to take us a little while to figure it out, but just stay tuned and we'll tell you. Okay? So that was the story. Let us look then at the future of the euro. So what is the future of the euro going to be? I mean, these are not real euros, but they could look like this in you know, some fancy time when we go to space and everything else. So it's going to be whatever Germany and France decide. That's what it's going to be. Okay? So the UK has nothing to do with this. The UK was always out, and cares what it does and how it manages its Brexit. Only the UK people care, okay? For the rest of you, it's a shame that we don't have the UK participating in our conversation, but it was not Club Europe anyway. So you want to leave, you know, Godspeed. Like, what can we do about it, right? So it will be whatever Germany and France decide. And why is that? Because you see, they have the majority in this society. These are the largest economies. They're 50%. And the euro is the decision of Germany and France to integrate their economies and share a common currency. There has always been a euro in Europe, and there will always be a euro in Europe, no matter what. It's called the Deutschmark. Holland does not have a currency. It does whatever, it never will. It cannot. It's too small. It's too close to Germany. And it's included in the Deutschmark, inside the euro, outside the euro, or whatever you do. Belgium is not even a country because it's two countries. And half of it is Germany and the other half is France, okay? And we keep this fiction that but it's not. And part of it is the Deutschmark and part of it is the franc. Okay? And keep going. Austria, of course, is not a country. What's that? I mean, how many people live there? And you know, and keep going, keep and no, nothing. Denmark? Are you kidding me? Denmark a country? That's ridiculous. That's a lander. Of course, they're all landers of Germany. And they will be. And they will share a euro. So now you're not hearing my music, which is I'm getting very upset that you're not hearing my music, which is a big shame because this was Love is in the Air. Na, 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 na. Okay.
Love is in the air. Every sight and every sound.
Okay, now it's working. All right. But this was also, you see, Frau Merkel is so resistant that she gets to dance with all these people, right? And so let me ask you a second question. You think that Chancellor Merkel is going to win the next German federal election? Yes, but I'm going to introduce them now. Yes, they will be formally there. But I'm just asking you so that you remember where it came. So you saw Frau Merkel, Chancellor. Let me be professional. Chancellor Merkel dancing first with President Sarkozy, and then with President Hollande. And now in September and September 24th, she has to run for election again. Will she win? Okay. And if she doesn't. The next question is, do you think that the next German chancellor will have to dance with Marine Le Pen? Because it's going to make a big difference for the euro. Who she gets to dance with, who the next German chancellor gets to dance with, okay? So you have to ask me, so what about the other guys? Well, you know, the rest are like the little dwarfs. You know, so you know Snow White, that's a story about Snow White and her stepmother, and everything else is just irrelevant. They're just really minor secondary characters because we don't add up to anything, really. You know, from 21 you go to 15 and then Spain and then everybody else is just really tiny. This is an old story. You know what? Actually, France is not calling the shots in this one either. So it's not really two, it's whatever Germany says. There was a story. You know, I don't see this guy here, but you know who this guy is, right? This is Henry Kissinger. He was Secretary of State during the 70s when Turkey invaded Cyprus and there was a big mess, okay? And he was concerned and he said, look, yes. So he said, what is the phone number for Europe? Who should I call? Now we know. Now we know who they have to call. That is Europe's phone number. Okay? So you call to that phone, you know what's gonna happen? This is what's gonna happen. So the phone rings, okay? Phone rings. Okay? And you can ask anything you want. Like you can say, all right, you know, hello, Ms. Merkel, should we reform the treaties and make the European Union more operative and less bureaucratic? That's what the Brits want. Should we design a plan to restructure the debt of the periphery? That would be like such a great idea. Should we create a common deposit insurance facility for all the countries in the euro area? Keep asking anything you want. You know what she answers? She always answers the same exact same three words. This is what Chancellor Merkel says. She says, Nein zu allen, which means no to everything. Okay? So that's what we have right now. Okay, and now this is the last bit. What about the future? Like this is what we are here for, and you've spent all your minutes and many more, and you haven't even started. Okay, so let me very quickly tell you what I think about the future, and if you force me, you know, prudent economist, and I think I'm one, never say a number and a date in the same sentence. So this is about some future, I don't know when, and I really don't know much what's gonna happen about the future, but okay, so I'm gonna discuss some of the possible futures for the euro. And actually, you know, there's like three doors, it's a game with three doors. So one door is simply remain. And that's what we're gonna do. So Brexit, some guys are gonna exit, and simply remain means let's stay with Germany. Let's stick through this with Germany and France, unless France exits. And if France exits, but let's still remain. Because somebody is gonna keep the euro or is gonna change the euro back into a Deutschmark. And it will be very important, and you can ask me about that, how this thing gets broken up, okay? The other one, of course, is just exit, now, which is what the British are trying to do, not from the euro, but yes, from the eurozone. It's much, much easier to leave the eurozone. There even is an article in the treaties that say how you're supposed to do it, not so for the euro. And of course, what's the third one? Well, the third one is this fanfare thing, is let's finally get started the European Confederation, or the Confederate States of Europe, because that's the only other alternative. That's the only other workable thing that we might attempt, okay? It's not easy, it requires building institutions, it's a secret plan, if there is such a plan. We don't know how we're gonna get there, it's not gonna be easy at all, but you know, I don't see any other doors. In fact, there's not really three doors, it's more like two, like there's two things are gonna happen. So either we're gonna go to some euro, different euro, or the whole thing is gonna collapse, okay? So that's the euro collapse, okay? And it's gonna be one of them, okay? The new white paper that was published just on March 1st calls for a deeper and fairer economic union. So it's starting to sound good to our Greek friends, because the fair part, that's what they like. The deeper will have to be the price, okay? It's gonna be the price, but you're gonna get it fairer, okay? And maybe it doesn't mean like blonder, it means more just, okay? And that's the Euro 2.0. And in fact, let me read this very long quote by my favorite person. Where are you headed, Europe? That's what it asks. And the answer is, I don't know. The white paper on the future of Europe presented by the President of the European Commission on March 1st, 2017 doesn't answer this question, but it's required reading nonetheless. All you guys should download it and read it, because there you have the clues. The five different scenarios it proposes range from a disappointing step backward to a single market that rescinds the free movement of people to a confederated Europe for everyone. So we might go back to a single market with no free, it will no longer be an economic union, there won't be free mobility of people. People will have restrictions to emigrate and to work in other countries, just like you guys are wanting to do for here. Okay, and the three in between are to build a multi-speed Europe. So that's an important idea, multi-speed Europe. Can we manage this? How does a multi-speed euro work? Are you in, are you out? Can you be in between, in and out, and what conditions? So that's gonna be an important idea to, deal with, forge ahead, deal with the problems as they arise, or stay the course, but do it more efficiently. In the prologue of this piece of paper that I recommend your reading, Juncker asks us, let's be patient and wait until September. So it's just around the corner, just let the summer go by, and it's gonna be September eventually, and there he's gonna provide us more details in his State of the Union, the State of Speech. And of course, what he's gonna do is he will know the results of the Dutch, French, and German elections. Brexit negotiations will have commenced, if the House of Lords and the Parliament in the UK decide that it's about the right time, and Greek debt restructuring will be around the corner, because it cannot really feasibly happen before Germany. But it's gonna be the topic for, remember this, this bald guy from Spain said that insulted most of us, and then he said, Greeks' debt will be restructured in the fall of 2017. Hey, there I did it. I said a number, and I said a date, okay? That's what it is. And to me, this European club dream today seems like a distant memory. We used to be Sebastian and I, we were young and strong and beautiful once, believe it or not, and look at us now. You know, so that's more or less how Europe believes. So these are the five scenarios. Keep them in mind because the third question is about these five scenarios. Okay, and just to finish, let me just tell you the European risk calendar. So it's in all your minds. And if you want to do some trades, there's some trades to be done. Brexit, is it going to be hard, soft? When is it going to start? Dutch general election next week. Okay, next week exactly. It's going to be. Yeah, it's a small country, but it might make a difference because there could be French presidential election, big country, is going to be in April, the end of April. German on September, and then of course Greece is still unresolved, and there goes. I didn't do any. This is no Photoshop. She does it. I can quote her. You know, it's there. You can find this picture. Okay. And of course this is what these guys want. So Brexit, give me 1 minute and I'm done. So Brexit. It's like Brexit is like your eggs for breakfast, your boiled eggs. How do you want them? Hard or soft? Okay? And of course Brexit means Brexit. But the House of Lords said not in March. Which was the promise, right? It was gonna be Brexit. Article 50 will be invoked in March. Well, not any longer, because there's no dates left, given that the filibustering of the Lords have decided, nah, it's not going to be in March. So this is, look at this guy. I mean, doesn't he remind you of somebody? So he is here at Wilder, he will be running for, and this is Marine, and this is Frank, and of course the Greek thing, and if everything fails, of course we have the collapse of the euro, and who gets to keep the euro is going to be a very important question. If not, we can always go back. This is a 50 mark banknote, for those of you who have long memories or were alive then, and that's always a possibility. And of course, if you're in Greece, this is what's going to happen first. First, they will stamp your euros and put this word, which in Greek means drachmas, and then we'll go back to this thing, which was a 1,000 drachma note. It'll be a newer one, okay? So they'll use different designs and so on. Okay. But you know what? Even if all these horrendous things happen, you shouldn't worry too much, because after all, this is just monetary games. You know what? The real economy will still function, and this Greek shipping lines will still go all over the planet moving things, because that's what they've been doing for forever, with the euro, inside the euro, during and outside the euro, and they will still work. And this is probably one of my favorite three spots in the planet. And this spot is a hotel in Santorini. And this hotel is still gonna be one of my favorite spots in the planet forever. In fact, every year I'm hoping, let euro exit this year. And I buy a month in August, which I cannot afford. I cannot afford, barely afford 2 days, let alone a month. If they devalue, then I can go. Okay, and then around the end of May, I canceled my reservation because except that now they're getting to know me. Okay, so this is the funny Spaniard that wants to spend a month and then always something happens and cancels. Okay, so since it's my favorite hotel, I thought I'll give him some airtime and tell you where it is. The grapes in south of Europe will mature every September, and we're gonna harvest them, and we're gonna turn them into wine like we've always done, with the euro or without the euro. Okay, with the Germans or breathing in our necks or without them. So the last question is, will the euro still exist in March 2022, which is 5 years from now? What do you think? And then the second question is, what is your most likely scenario if, like of the five we've mentioned or some other, how are you gonna make, if you say yes, what's gonna happen? And if you say no, what might happen? Okay, so that's thank you. Sorry, I apologize.
Amazing presentation.
Tour de force, call it a tour de force.
Tour de force. We're gonna give him one of those little medals. So let me, before we start the dinner, I want you to repeat the three questions for the tables.
Oh, yes.
I wanna ask you, there are so many questions I wanna ask you. Do you really mean what you said at the end, that it doesn't matter? So we've been so anxious for so long, and it really doesn't matter? Well, and the reason I'm asking you the question, and let me ask it in a more specific way. you showed the interest rate data, and what it basically showed is that interest rates in Southern Europe were like 20% just before the euro was not launched, but the launching was decided. And what happened was that there was this convergence, and even though now there's interest rates have separated, they are not 20%, except in Greece, which is like the default risk. But interest rates in Spain, what are they now? 5%, 6%? Yeah. So, I mean.
Maybe a little bit less now.
Yeah, so 4%. So if the peseta was around, the interest rate in Spain would be what, 15%? It would be in, I don't know, like Argentina, right? So do you really think that it doesn't matter?
Well, it's no, okay. So I of course I use a little bit of literary license there, and I exaggerated just a tiny bit. It's not that it doesn't matter. What I mean is there is a lower bound to all this catastrophe that sometimes we
But you're talking your book now, because you live there, so you don't want it to. It's wishful thinking. You don't want it to collapse.
No. There will be, you know, from what we know from similar processes of breakup of countries, basically there's going to be a short-term recession, post-breakup recession, for sure. There's going to be a lot of volatility. There's going to be a short-lived post-breakup recession, a major devaluation in whomever does not get the euro. Because a very nice way to break the euro or would be kicking Germany out,
right.
letting the countries that are going to have their currencies appreciate get out of the euro.
So
and keep the euro.
That's a great idea. So listen to what he said. He said the euro is sort of an artificial construct, and in reality we have countries that are too different, and everyone had been thinking for a long time, well, the way to deal with this is to make it more homogeneous, and that means kick out Greece, maybe Portugal, maybe Italy and Spain. But then someone came with the idea, no. The thing to do is to kick out Germany. And then we have the Germans out, and everything will be fantastic, except that it's the Germans who run the central bank and provide the anchor. Let me ask you two more questions, because we have to eat, and I want to allow our guests to ask two questions before dinner, and then I want you to repeat them. So too many questions. So one of the issues with the euro and the crisis, the Greek and the Spanish crisis, is that these countries started to run very large deficits, and their external deficit was huge. And in Spain, it was like, I don't know, 10, 15% of GDP, never seen anywhere else. Same thing in Greece. And as you said, since they couldn't change the nominal value of their currency, because they didn't have no currency anymore, then they lost competitiveness and the deficit went larger and larger. So let me ask you a question. Do you know what is the deficit of Beverly Hills? No. Of Illinois? I don't know the answers either.
No.
I'm not asking you, and I know the answer. So the question is, how come that we don't worry in the U.S. about the deficit in Illinois or the surplus in North Dakota? They have a lot of shale gas. So they probably have a surplus in their trade with the rest of the. But we don't know. Why is it that? And I know, but I want you to keep me your answer.
Okay.
Why is it that we worry and people are now looking, the deficit in Spain is, or the surplus is shrinking and they will soon go back into deficit? We have no idea in this country why. What's going on with
that? So I guess there's two reasons. One reason is Article 104B of the Maastricht Treaty that explicitly prohibits fiscal transfers. I mean, the reason why you don't worry about the deficit in the U.S. is because you don't know the transfers either, and you don't want to find out. Because if California knows how much it's sending to Alabama, why do we want to do this? I mean, do we really want to do this? And I know this game because they play it in Spain. And they come up with some numbers, and they say, because notice that, and then the second question has to do with the geographical limits of solidarity. So in Spain, you know, people in the people in Europe, Europe ends at in Cádiz, and Morocco is 20 kilometers there, and you can go to Cádiz and you can have dinner in a nice restaurant, and you're watching the lights, and they're just there. You could swim there. People swim there. Okay, so but not one euro goes there, because that's us and that's them, and this is us. And solidarity in Europe ends in Cádiz and doesn't go 1 kilometer further away. Now you guys are saying, and you can do the same thing here, solidarity ends exactly in San Diego and not 20 centimeters down. And of course, when you say that's the end of solidarity, then you start worrying, what are the fiscal deficits? And of course, you know the deficit. Of course, the deficit of Mexico is a concern for the U.S. and the U.S. deficit.
So let me open up. Do we have mics for the audience here? Let me open for two or three questions from the audience. And we don't have mics, but I have a mic here. Do we have mics? Oh, they went.
Okay, thank you very much, Professor Diaz, for the talk. I'm a bit biased, I'm Spanish also, so I kind of understand and agree totally with your point of view. But actually what I would like to ask you is just to know your opinion on something that I find interesting. So I think from a Spanish perspective, and as far most of the European people and friends I know, everybody agrees that the European Union is more or less okay, that the euro is not going to break tomorrow, and that Brexit is more a pain in the ass than anything else. However, when I read American media or international media, the international press, everybody seems to be waiting for the collapse of the European Union, and sometimes there is this impending... Okay, sorry. This impending doom feeling, like the press, the foreign press is constantly talking about how the European Union is about to collapse, whereas I think people in Europe actually know that it's not going to collapse soon. So why do you think is this interest in seeing the EU collapse, or do you even think this interest actually exists?
Okay, great question. We're going to collect three questions and then allow Professor Diaz.
Hello. Thank you very much for the talk. I have a question about the Brexit effect, more what if the EU exists as well, because I'm also biased, I'm French, so I just want the EU to work out. What happened if the EU leave quite abruptly, and in the end all the companies that want to remain in the EU will have to settle somewhere else? The question remains, where will they settle? Because we know that Luxembourg is a good place for, you know, on the tax aspect, corporation aspect. So what will be the effect? Where companies will go? What economy will be affected by this leave?
You're talking about Brexit, right?
Yeah, exactly. And the companies living there that have to move into Europe. So what will be the effect?
Thank you so much. On the International Women's Day, we need questions from our women colleagues. Yes.
So you asked, or you opined that the exit does matter, if the EU collapse does matter. And you mentioned that, you know, the recession is going to be short term. But my question is, you know, there are poor economies who may not be able to ride through the recession. It might become permanent. So could you respond to that?
Okay, one more question. Okay, we'll have opportunity, of course, for the tables to interact and then to answer the three questions that Javier has asked. So, why don't you? You have
okay.
Your own.
All right. So let me quickly answer the interest on the euro collapse. You know, journalists have to tell stories. That's their job, and they are they have to entertain us. And why not? I mean, this is always going to be an exciting story. Good news doesn't sell newspapers. So it has to be. Let's talk about the collapse. And it's kind of nice to think about these scenarios as well. Okay, so I really don't think there is any more to that. And some, you know, there's always stories in the press. Like, remember, I remember the last big scare was at the beginning of 2016, actually it's Christmas of 2015, when we thought the world was going to stop because China's growth numbers were not what we thought they would be. And 2016 was going to be this disaster year because China was not going to grow at 6, but maybe it was growing at 4. And some people say, no, this is misinterpreted. It's too really. And what happened? Nothing. No, that did not happen. Okay, that did not happen. So now of course you've seen the risks. It's Europe faces risks every election for sure. There's many countries. There are many elections. Brexit moves things along because, you know, imagine there's this row of penguins and they are all sitting there and they're getting hungry, and down there they sing herring. I mean, just big fat herring. But they don't know if there's an orca, a killer whale, underneath. They hide and they hang under the ledge, okay? And they're all sitting there. Now, when we see the UK exit, if it does exit, and it's not 100% that they are going to exit, when we see how it exits, we'll see what happens, okay? It will not be from the euro. So when the penguin that gets the hungriest jumps into the water, then two things happen. Either the whole, you know, either the killer whale is there and it's going to swallow that penguin, and the whole thing is going to become red and it's going to be just dramatic, or nothing happens. And if nothing happens, what do all the other penguins do? They jump in. So maybe everybody will leave. If the UK leaves, we'll know how deep or severe the recession is. Actually, I had a slide about the severity of the UK recession, but I thought I would not share it with you because there was no way I could substantiate. There were very small numbers, even in the worst case scenario of a hard exit and sending the UK back to WTO. Okay, so what impact will it have with companies? You know what? It's already had it in many cases. We don't know yet. So all the plans are in place. Companies are making decisions. They are relocating, and they are getting ready to relocate if necessary, further if necessary. And it will depend on the details. Europe can be very aggressive with Brexit, and the city of London can suffer severely from that. So what's the trade? Buy Dublin and buy Frankfurt and maybe buy Luxembourg, okay? Real estate or anything you want, or the stock exchange indexes, because there's going to be some reallocation of resources, and some of it has already happened. And the companies are already taking measures, and they have plans, because now this is a serious probability, okay? So, and the last one was, again about the euro collapse. What I was trying to say is, this doesn't matter, is that the real economy bounds below the recession of the euro. So which means, yes, it's gonna be rough for a little while, but not for very long. You know why? Because the rare thing, the exceptional thing is the euro. Europe has not had a common currency at all ever. It's more like, I guess we can go back to the gold standard or something. But you know, since we have the money we use, fiat money, there has not been a common currency, and everybody has managed a little bit better, a little bit worse, with more equality, with more inequality, with more corruption, with more inflation, with less inflation. They're gonna marry, they're gonna manage. And no, there's no such thing as a permanent recession. It does not happen, okay? And certainly, the duration of recessions is shorter in places that can manage the currency than in places that cannot manage the currency. Because you know, with Greece with a 50% devaluation will start growing tomorrow. Argentina, which is just another basket case of a country, has proved it. I mean, Argentina, after the huge devaluation, 2 years later it was growing. And yes, somebody's saying, oh, but they have soybeans and they have food. Yeah, it doesn't matter what you have, what you don't have. What you have is an incredibly depreciated currency that makes you competitive automatically and that allows you to sell your own stuff, you know, because you see, what the Europe is doing for Germany, it does two things. Germany, the Greek can never produce washing machines and sell them, because Germans are much more competitive at doing that. So Germany captures the entire European market because European countries cannot, they have to go the very hard way if they want to depreciate the real exchange rate. But then the second service that the rest of the world does to Germany is, because Greek and Spain and Italy and Portugal and all the periphery exists, the German mark, which is the euro, but now it's painted blue, like the electric color, but it's the same thing, doesn't appreciate. So Germany doesn't have to go through the pain that Switzerland has gone, because with this totally out of proportion surpluses in its current account and in its trade balance, Germany's currency is not appreciating. In fact, it's depreciating. Why? Because there's always a risk of breakup. So Germany is managing its currency much, much worse than China. And your president will never accuse Germany of currency manipulation, because it's the euro.
The Secretary of the Treasury already did.
They already did?
Germans are currency manipulators. And then he sort of apologized when he said it.
Okay, but
he already said
but you see, the story, the defense of Germany, of course, with this administration, they say all kinds of things. So this one, right? So I guess I shouldn't.
So listen, let's eat, and then we'll come back to you after the dinner.
So no permanent recessions. No, that then it's not a recession, it's something else. Okay, no, and we're not gonna see it. Think Iceland, no permanent recession. Huge devaluation, yes. Huge empowerment automatic with the rest of the world, no permanency. Iceland is growing.